Thank you for the organizers for putting together this nice workshop. So I want to talk about a fairly simple problem, in a sense. So it's the totally asymmetric exclusion process on a half line. So to explain what that is we have a number of boxes indexed with the natural numbers. If it's get going really bad, and just turn off the light. There's a infinite reservoir of particles on the left. Rules of the Tarsev are there's a particle sitting somewhere. There's an exponential clock. So there's a weight e to the lambda x. So the weight inside the lattice is 1. And then if the clock rings, the particle tries to jump to the right, never to the left. So it's totally asymmetric. And this jump only works if the side to the right is not occupied. So this particle cannot jump until this particle has jumped, while this particle can jump. And we start throwing in particles from the left. And here the insertion rate is alpha. So it's, again, an exponential clock ringing with rate alpha. And alpha is less than 1. And the question is very simple. Namely, so I forgot to say, this is joint work with Peter Mertas and a joint PhD student, also from Bath, Horacio Duhart Gonzalez. So the question is, we want to know the density in the lattice as time goes to infinity, and I'll be really very simple. I start from an empty lattice. So there are no particles at time t equals 0. I throw in particles, so the only parameter in the system is my insertion rate alpha. And there are two kinds of motivations for this problem. So the motivation one comes from PDEs, namely the hydrodynamic limit of these exclusion processes are Berger's equation, as we've seen in the last talk, without noise and diffusion. So the hydrodynamic limit is an equation dt rho plus dx f of rho equals 0. And here the flux f is rho times 1 minus rho. And so that has been studied for a number of settings. So for example, there's the work by Bahadurhan, Communication Mathematical Physics, maybe 2012. Yes. And the difficulty here is we live on a half line. So this is a conservation law. So there can be shocks. There can be rearfection fans. And that's essentially a well-understood theory. But now with the additional question, how do we prescribe boundary data for conservation laws? And that's also known. I mean, there's been a number of PDE results. And the first one I'm aware of is, so the question, how do we prescribe boundary data for conservation laws? Es wirkt bei French Group Bardot, Leroux, Nidalec, Communication Mathematical Physics 4 from 1979. And to explain why this is a non-trivial problem, let me sketch you a toy problem. So say we assume that the hydrodynamic limit of this task on the real line is Berger's equation on the real line with this flux function. What kind of boundary data can we prescribe? So let me say I look at Berger's equation on the real line, and I prescribe the initial data rho of x. 0 is alpha times the characteristic function of the left half line. So that's kind of the situation I'm looking at in my particle system. I have no particles at time t equals 0, but there's a reservoir of particles, in this case, coming from the left half line. And that's a system we can simply solve. That's a very simple calculation. So if you solve this with the method of characteristics, then so what do? I solve the system x dot of tor is in this case 1 minus 2z of t. I have the time variable t dot of tau is equal to 1, and z dot of t is equal to 0. So that would be the three quantities of determining my characteristic system. And I have the initial data. X of at time t is 0. And S I use to parameterize the position in X, so X of 0 is S, T of 0 S is 0, and Z of 0 S is alpha times the characteristic function of the half line. So I find I integrate the system of ODEs, set of TS is alpha times the characteristic function, T of tau S is tau, and the important thing, X of TS is S plus 1 minus 2Z times. So that's simply the way how we would solve a conservation law. And what you see here is this coefficient can change sign. So if alpha is less than 1/2, this is a positive sign. So the characteristics point up. So the data alpha is seen on the half line 0t, where I want to prescribe the boundary data. So that says if I insert particle at a low rate, if you believe that the toy model has something to do with the model I'm looking at, then the characteristics propagate the data on the left into the half line where I want to prescribe the boundary data. So I want to solve Berger's equation here. And the half line I want to prescribe the boundary data is, of course, the upper part in the Tx diagram. So alpha less than 1/2 is the easy case. However, my difficulty is if alpha is larger than 1/2, then This part, where I want to prescribe bounded data, is not reached from the left, and one can see that the half-line for the bounded data is in a reaffection train. And this theory of conservation laws I mentioned earlier says we can prescribe data in the region 1/2 1 in this case. So if I insert data with a rate alpha larger than 1/2, then something more complicated happens, and I'm not completely free to choose my bounded data. In the PD perspective, this comes from a vanishing viscosity approach, for example. And what I want to do is understand this from the point of view of particles, and I want to give a large deviation argument that explains this number 1/2. So essentially what I'm going to do for the rest of the lecture is develop quite a complicated theory to compute this number 1/2. I will also compute this number alpha, but that is actually a lot easier. So, and the method we were trying to use is a bit unusual. So it's something I want to spend quite some time on to explain that it's there's a fairly classical engine behind, namely the Gärtner-Ellis theorem, which is used to compute large deviations. But here we couple that to a particular tool, the so-called matrix product ansatz. And that required some playing around to make this method work. Essentially, that's what I would like to explain to you, how one can calculate large deviations using the matrix product ansatz. But before I come to this, let me sketch some known results on the TARZEP. So there's a very classic result by Liggett, transaction of the AMS 1979. And so he says the semi-infinite TARZEP is not ergodic. And there's no uniqueness this stationary measure. And to be a bit more precise, let me define the product measure nu alpha, depending on what will be the insertion rate alpha. So that's acting on all possible configurations in my lattice. So that's the set 0, 1, either the site is empty or it's filled with exactly one particle. There can never be two particles at the same position at the same time. And the product measure is defined for all cylinder functions, eta j1 equals to 1, eta j2 equals 1, up to eta jn equals 1. This is, if this is equal alpha to the n, then nu is a product measure. And a result of Liggett, which I will need, is the following. So if S is the generator of the process, and I look at suitable densities mu. I'm not very precise with suitable mean. I only say what I need in particular is that the number rho is defined as the limit of mu looking at the positions far out has to exist. Then one can show the following. For the first time, something on the particle level shows up, which we have seen in the conservation law a moment ago. If alpha is less equal than 1/2, then the limit as t going to infinity is either the product measure nu alpha, if rho is less or equal than 1 minus alpha, or it is some measure nu alpha rho, if rho is larger than 1 minus alpha. And in the alternative case, alpha larger than 1/2 is long-term limit, I get mu s of t is either mu alpha with rho equal to 1/2, if rho is less equal than 1/2, or mu alpha rho if rho is larger than 1/2. And essentially, always the case alpha less than 1/2 will be easy. I'll deal with it for completeness. The difficult part is the case alpha greater than 1/2. Since then, correlations will build up. And yes, I forgot to mention the second motivation, since I only listed motivation one, but motivation two is the TARSIP is kind of a typical prototype, a paradigmatic process for non-equilibrium systems. So it's a prototype for non-equilibrium systems. So on the one hand, it makes the analysis more complicated. There are correlations. One of the questions we want to study is, in equilibrium, we often use large deviation theory to obtain thermodynamic descriptions. And I'll define later on what large deviation theory is, but essentially, it's a way to calculate free energies, if one wants. And it's not at all clear whether the same is true in non-equilibrium. Many people believe it, and we try to make some step towards here. There's a lot of work by Bertini and co-workers, and here we try to look at this question for this particular system in a very special case. Really, it's very special in the sense that I only look at the density at time t equals infinity. I would like to do much more. I would really like to have the dynamic rate functional describing the evolution of the free energy, but that's something we can't do at all at the moment. And the reason why I'm confined to the limit t going to infinity is that we know here something about stationary measures, and there is some more characterization of those measures in terms of matrix product undot, in terms of matrix product. Alpha is, from now on, alpha will be the rate of the Poisson clock in the lattice left. And here alpha is not. The mu? Mu. So that's a mu which I said only is a suitable measure. There are some assumptions which I wouldn't like to discuss in detail. There exists these mu rho and mu rho alpha and mu 1/2 alpha. So and that has to exist. I mean, that's one of the assumptions on you. So what I'm going to use now is a characterization of these stationary measures by so-called matrix products. So that's the matrix product ansatz, and I'll call it later on MPA. And that appears in a paper by Derrida, Evans, Hakim, and Pasqui. JFIS A26 from 1993. And what I'm going to use is results from the PhD thesis of Stefan Koskinski. Actually, a student of Herbert Spohn, and I think the thesis was 2004. And essentially, what Stefan did in his thesis, among a number of other things, was to prove the following theorem about existence of invariant measures. The statement is apparently rather implicit. It says, suppose there are matrices D and E, non-negative matrices. There are vectors V and W, and there is a number C, positive number, such that the following holds. The matrix product D plus E is equal to D plus E. Alpha W transpose times E is equal to W transpose, and C times B plus E multiplied with V is equal to V. So assume that we can find matrices and vectors satisfying this condition. Sorry? Yes. I'll write them down for you later on. Then suitable parameters, and in particular that will be the non-trivial case alpha larger than 1/2. The following holds true. The measure, which I call nu alpha bar c, acting on zetas in my space 0, 1 to the n, taking prescribed value for the first n sites this measure defined as the following: W transpose times the product k equals 1 to n eta k d plus 1 minus eta k e times V divided by W transpose V plus E to the N times V is invariant. So if you want, if you manage to find the matrices, that's a characterization of an invariant measure. And, well, Stefan doesn't mention in his thesis, it probably was obvious to him. It wasn't completely obvious to us, so we needed to prove that. So what is true is that this measure agrees with the one from Liggett's theory. So, to be precise, nu alpha, nu c alpha bar is equal to mu alpha rho if C is rho times 1 minus rho. And alpha is greater or equal than 1 half. Before I continue, this looks abstract, complicated. Sometimes it is. However, there are different processes which can be described by this matrix product ANDAZ. And what you can kind of think is that D and E stand for empty and full sites. And these matrix product ANDAZ formula here incorporate the way of how the dynamics works, how a particle can jump to the right, and how a full site can be annihilated, how an empty site can be annihilated by a particle jumping from the left. So that's kind of a formal way of encoding it. And in some sense, that's how you prove this statement that really there's a characterization of the limit measures obtained by Liggett. If you look at Liggett's proof, it's actually almost immediate to translate what he has proved into the matrix product ANDAZ. It's not at all a difficult proof. Yes. Yes. Well, in full generality, I haven't understood it. So here I can write down something that works. One of the questions is, how far does the method I present here for the task extend to other processes? And there are some processes where people say, we believe there is no matrix product ANDAZ representation, but that's not completely clear to show. But there are a number of processes which can be written in such a way. So finally, towards the theory I want to discuss. Aim, what you want to do is we want to study the empirical density 1 over n sum k equals 1 to n eta k. Again, eta is 0 or 1, depending on whether the site k is occupied or vacant. In the limit, t goes to infinity, and initially, no particles in the lattice. And the method I want to do is a last deviation argument. So again, that's something most of you know very well. For those who don't know it, in essence it is, I want to look at the logarithm of some probability of xn being in some set A. Then I divide by 1 over n. I take the limit to infinity, and this should be equal to minus infimum for x in A of A in x. And here I is a function from 0, 1, the possible state of densities, to 0 infinity, lower semi-continuous, and it's called the rate function. So what I'm essentially struggling to do is I try to compute the rate function, and it will turn out the minimizers of the rate function are precisely the values alpha, respectively 1 half, depending on low or large particle insertion rate. So the rate function recovers the boundary data I can prescribe. And the statement of the theorem is as follows. The result fits nicely. So, well known is for alpha less than 1/2. There is a rate function, and it is of the form x log x over alpha plus 1 minus x log 1 minus x divided by 1 minus alpha. That's well known. That basically is classic theory. The interesting case is the one for larger insertion rates. And then it turns out that the rate function is more complicated. I first get the similar expression, x log x over alpha plus 1 minus x log 1 minus x divided by 1 minus alpha. But now I get an additional term, logarithm of 4 alpha times 1 minus alpha for x between 0 and 1 minus alpha. I get 2 x log x plus 1 minus x log 1 minus x plus log 2 for x between 1 minus alpha and 1/2. And I get the same expression without the 2 in the rest of the domain. So let me show you in pictures what this result means. That's more intuitive than the formula. So the easy case, alpha less than 1/2. If I plot the rate function, then it's a nice and convex function that has the minimizer. So if this is the plot for alpha 2, this is the plot for alpha 1, and I have alpha 1 is less than alpha 2 is less than 1/2, the minimizer is always the corresponding alpha. So that means this SOM empirical density converges in probability to alpha, and we recover the boundary data alpha. And in the case alpha larger than 1/2, yeah, this picture is different. So here, I always have the same value for the right half of the parabola. And then on the left, it changes. So let me sketch two values. So that's alpha 3 and alpha 4. And I have 1/2 is less than alpha 3, less than alpha 4. The minimizer is always 1/2. So xn converges to 1/2. It is precisely the lower value we can attain according to the Bardot-Leroux-Nidelec theory. And in terms of physics, this means there are two phase transitions. in the system. Haste condition means non-analyticity of the rate function. And you see that, of course, from the directly from the formula. The formula has two breakpoints. So 1 minus alpha and 1 half are the 2 points where phase transitions occur. Okay, so let me sketch the proof, since that's really where we had to try to combine this matrix product ANDAZ with last deviation theory. And that had been done before. There's in particular work by Derrida and co-workers. And they used a saddle point method. And we tried to do something similar here, but we failed. So we had to come up with a different way of obtaining a rigorous mathematical result. So the tool for the proof is the Gärtner-Ellis theorem, and that says the following. We look at the cumulant generating function lambda of theta defined as the limit n going to infinity of 1 over n log expectation of e to the n theta xn. If lambda exists and is differentiable, then there is a large deviation principle, and the rate function is simply given as the Legendre transform of the cumulant generating function. Yes, this is here. I take expectations with respect to the stationary measure. Yeah, that will actually probably be the next line I'm going to write down. So in principle, it's very simple. We have to calculate this expectation. And there already the matrix product ANDAZ comes in, since I have to calculate the expectation with respect to the stationary measure. The stationary measure is characterized by the matrix product ANDAZ. And then we have to make sense of this expression. So how to combine Gärtner-Ellis and the matrix product ANDAZ in this case. As I said, there is work using saddle point methods, which we couldn't apply here. So what we do is we first look at the moment generating function, which is the expression on the left without the limit n going to infinity and without the logarithm. So I simply calculate the expectation of e to the n theta xn. Theta is my variable, and xn is the empirical density for the first n sites. And that's a fairly easy calculation. Here we use that we know what the empirical measure is, so we obtain W transpose e to the theta d plus e to the n times v divided by w transpose d plus e to the n times v. And that can be written differently. C to the n, c is the c from the matrix product ANDAZ, divided by w transpose times v times w transpose e to the theta d plus e to the n times v. So we need to find DEVW, calculate this expression, make sure that it exists, and that we can take the logarithm and take then the limit n going to infinity. One result here for suitable parameters. And that leaves that c is equal to 1/4. I obtain that the Cuban generating function has a relatively simple expression. Namely, it is 1 over n log w transpose e to the theta times d plus e to the n times v minus 2 log 2. So we need to calculate this expression, take the Fourier transform, take the Legendre transform, and we are done. However, calculating this expression is not easy, and that has to do with the fact that d and e are infinite matrices. So let me sketch a wrong idea, which we forced our PhD student to pursue for quite some time until we realized that it was rubbish. The idea was here, V and E are infinite matrices. And the idea was truncate, then use Perron Frobenius to calculate the spectrum of the truncated matrices, take the limit n go to infinity, and then let the truncation vanish. And that, as we found out the hard way, gives the wrong result. So we cannot truncate to finite matrices and then take the limit. We really lose essential information contained in the vectors v and w. So we have to deal with the infinite dimensional problem. You mean what? I would say we spent 2 or 3 months, and then we sat down, and one evening I did some calculation mathematics, and I realized, no, this cannot work. I mean, yeah. Well, you know what it's like to be a PhD student with me, right? yeah, we treated Horacio well, hardly, but he survived. And so he came up with very nice ideas. And well, I'm going to explain to you what we did in the end. And there are lots of very tedious calculations, which I'm not going to mention at all. And Horacio became a great master in doing horrendously complicated calculations. And in the end, he managed to simplify everything that it became actually quite a simple and elegant method. So what we had decided to do is we want to calculate, I just deleted this. Well, I had an expression for lambda. And the way how we then, in the end, proved that we have an expression for lambda is to give a lower bound, an upper bound, and show that they match. So it's confusing since I have to say what I mean with lower and upper bound. I always refer to the cumulant generating function when I say lower and upper. For the rate function, it would be the opposite. So how much time do I have, Jeremy? Thank you. So essentially, I want to sketch the upper bound, since that explains what the matrix product unnuts looks like. The first thing is, what we showed is the matrix product unnuts is satisfied for B being the identity matrix with ones in the line one above the diagonal. E is the transpose. W transpose is 1, 1 over alpha minus 1, 1 over alpha minus 1 squared, and so on. And V transpose is 1, 2, 3. So, I mean, that's something Horacio became a great expert. He simply has found a number of representations of matrix product unders. If you plug this into the assumption of the theorem of Kosinski, you find that all three conditions are met. So essentially, we can calculate the cumulative generating function. The difficulty is only we have to take e to the theta times d plus e, raise it to the power n, multiply it with w and v, and then take the logarithm of the limit. So it's still non-trivial. And what we did on the attempt to truncate wasn't completely wasted, since we could extend the idea to the infinite dimensional setting. So since we really wanted to have a clear theorem, we needed to introduce function spaces, and these are weighted L2 spaces. So L2S is the space of sequences xk such that xk squared s to the k is finite for some s. And why is this a nice space? Then V is in L2S, and A of theta, which is this matrix I need to calculate, e to the theta d plus e, which I need to raise to the nth power, is bounded from L2S into itself. And so let me see how much I want to. Okay, maybe I try to explain this a little bit more, then I don't say much about the upper bound, about the lower bound. So what did we want to compute? Lambda of theta, the cumulative generating function, was the limit n going to infinity. That's the formula I had on the board a couple of minutes ago. Log of W transpose A of theta to the n V minus 2 log 2. And that is, I apply Cauchy Schwarz. I kick out the W part, since that's independent of n. Those parts depend on n. And I find that this is the less equal than the limit of n going to infinity of 1 over n logarithm a map Ts, which I will define in a second, times a tilde theta to the n v in L2. Minus 2 log 2. I think this is now, this is L2. Sorry, I forgot. Ts inverse. So we don't like to do spectral analysis in this weighted space. Therefore, we introduce a map, Ts, that maps. There's an isomorphism between L2S and L2. So there's not really much happening. Essentially, this A theta is t times a tilde times t inverse. So only a tilde is the equivalent in L2 rather than in L2S. And now we use what we learned while trying to work with the truncations. This matrix has a nice structure. It's a triplet matrix. So here we can really rigorously calculate the spectrum. That is the logarithm of the spectrum of A minus 2 log 2. And if you calculate the spectrum, that's fairly easy. Simply apply a standard theorem to calculate the spectrum of such a matrix. That's not hard. You find that's the logarithm of 1 plus square root of s plus e to the theta 1 plus 1 over square root of s minus 2 log 2. And at the moment, it was for any weight s in an admissible range, 0, 1, I think, no, 1 half 1, I think. Then the left side is independent of s, so you can minimize over s. If you do this, then you obtain an upper bound of the rate function. And that turns out to the three cases that correspond to the three cases of the rate functional. Since that's simply the Legendre transform of the upper bound I would obtain here, which I simply don't write down since it's technical. The lower bound I will only say very little about. So my feeling is the upper bound is a relatively robust method. So that works, I think, in a relatively general context. We haven't used much about the process, except that we could write down the matrices V and E, and the vectors V and W. The lower bound really requires more insight. And the idea was we look at this expression e to the theta d plus e to the power n. And of course, that can be written as a polynomial. And the only thing I have used is that e's always come in front of the d's. If it happens the other way around, by the matrix product rules, I can eliminate them. So dE, I can deal with since dE is d times e is equal to d plus e. So that's why I have a particular order here. And we only want a lower bound. So we only look at what I would call extreme cases, f pp n and f p 0 n. And here we really have to work to find reasonably explicit expressions in terms of binomial functions of n choose k expressions. And essentially what happens is we say the cumulative generating function is bounded from below by this 1 over n logarithm, of course. And now we only look at selected terms. So I drop most of the coefficients, and I only keep the simple ones, so f, p, p, n, of theta to the p minus 2 log 2. And here you have a relatively simple expression, which I'm not going to write down, but this is really an expression which is essentially in the realm of calculus. So if you massage that expression, you get a lower bound. And that comes in two different branches, and then you do the same with fp0 instead of fpp. You get two more branches, so you have four, but two of them agree, so you get three branches of the cumulative generating function. And then the last very easy step is you find that the lower and upper bound agree, and Gärtner-Ellis assumptions are satisfied. So that's no complete calculus. We only have to check differentiability. There's nothing difficult behind. And yeah, that's what I want to present as the method which we could deal with this particular case. We haven't tried it for any other process which can be described by matrix product unders. There are lots of things we can't do. And for example, we would love to calculate not only the limit t going to infinity, we would like to have a dynamic rate functional, really the analogous to what Jensen and Baradhan have done for the task on the real line. But we can't, at the moment, I have no idea how to do that. And even in this simple case, we only look at the long-time asymptotics, there are a number of regimes which we can't study with. My feeling is that, ironically, the one regime which where this method works is the hardest one, since the matrix product undots gives me a characterization of the stationary measure in the complicated case, alpha greater than 1/2. There are lots of parameters I've glossed over which still have to be investigated in that regime. But there are other situations. So there's a lot in the parameter regime which we haven't understood. And as I said, even less, we have no idea about the dynamic situation. Thank you very much for your attention. In this situation, yes. There are other situations that we don't know. In particular, I gave a full characterization of the stationary states obtained by Liggett. And that includes two cases for alpha less than 1/2, depending on the value of rho, which was the limit of mu at infinity. In those cases, it's not clear that there is a matrix product undot, for example. So we can't even speak of identity when we don't know that whether the one exists.